Good morning, everybody. Myself, Srimati H. Asha, Associate Professor, Department of Physics, ADB First Grade College, Harpanhalli. In this video, I'll discuss about Hall effect. Hall effect was proposed by Edwin Hall in the year 1879. So he explained that when a magnetic field is applied perpendicular to a current-carrying conductor, a voltage or an electric field is developed across the specimen in a direction perpendicular to both the electric field and the magnetic field. This phenomena is called the Hall effect. That is, when an electric field is applied, suppose along the x direction, and the magnetic field is applied along the z direction, an electric field is going to produce along the y direction. So let us understand how exactly the electric field is going to produce along the y direction. So for that, I am considering it a specimen for which the electric field is applied along the x direction by means of this battery. Now let us consider the current is carried in this specimen by electrons of charge minus E. So now the magnetic field is applied along the z direction. When the both electric field and magnetic field is applied simultaneously on the specimen, the charge carriers experiences a transverse deflecting force. Due to this, the charges start deflecting towards the lower surface of the specimen. Consequently, the positive charges start collecting at the upper surface. As we know that the motion of charges constitutes an electric current, and the conventional direction of the electric current is from positive to negative, the current starts flowing from this direction, that is along this direction, downward direction it is going to flow. So the motion of charges continues until an equilibrium condition is attained. Equilibrium condition is nothing but the force experienced by the charges due to electric field becomes exactly equal to the force experienced by the charges due to magnetic field, then the motion of charges stops. Consequently, an electric field is going to develop in the direction, and the downward direction I am showing here because it is nothing but a conventional direction. Thereby, a voltage is going to develop along the y direction. In this way, when electric field and magnetic field is applied simultaneously in a mutually perpendicular direction, an electric field is going to develop in a y direction. This effect is known as Hall effect. Now in this one, let us calculate a Hall coefficient. So consider the mathematical equations here. The electrons experiences a force due to electric field is given by the expression minus E into E. The negative sign indicates, as I have considered, electrons are the conduction electrons in this explanation. So negative sign has to be included here, where capital E is the strength of the electric field. The force experienced by the charges due to magnetic field is given by the expression E into V into H, where E is the charge on the electron, V the velocity with which the electrons are moving, H the strength of the magnetic field applied. The total force experienced by the charges is nothing but a sum of this force and sum of this force, that is nothing but F is equal to this expression. In equilibrium condition, as F is equal to 0, we have to equate this to the 0, then we will get the electric field as E is equal to V into H, because the E and E gets cancels here. This is known as Hall electric field, or even you can refer it as a Hall voltage. Now consider, by definition of current density, I can get the value of V as minus I into NE. Substituting this value back in this expression in place of V, we will get electric field as minus I into H divided by NE. Replacing this minus 1 by NE by RH, we will get the expression for electric field as E is equal to RH I into H. This RH is nothing but a minus 1 by E. E is known as Hall coefficient of the material. The Hall coefficient of the material, if it is negative sign, then we can say the conduction carriers are electrons. If the Hall coefficient is positive, then one can say the specimen, the current is conducted due to the holes. So this is the expression for Hall coefficient, and this Hall coefficient can be determined experimentally in the laboratory. Now I will explain the experimental determination of Hall coefficient in the laboratory. The experimental setup looks like this. Consider a slab of several centimeter long, several millimeter wide and a several millimeter thick. Okay, and the electric field is applied along the x direction by means of this battery, and the magnetic field is applied along the z direction, which is again not shown in the diagram. As the voltage is going to develop along the y direction, a leads is to be connected at the point A and point B to the calibrated potential meter, by which one can measure the Hall voltage developed across the specimen in a y direction. The amount of current flowing in the specimen can be measured with the help of a milliammeter. Now consider the expression for theoretical expression for Hall electric field, that is given as E is equal to RH into I into H here. By definition of current density, we always define the current density as it's the amount of current flowing across the conductor per unit area in unit time. Therefore, we can write this current density as I divided by B into D, where B is breadth of the specimen and D is the thickness of the specimen. Replacing I in this equation by this one, we'll get electric field expression as this, RH into I by breadth into thickness into H. So taking this D to the left hand side, if we write like this, E into D is equal to RH I into H by B. So this, the product can be replaced it by a voltage. This is based on the theory that capacitor theory. Why capacitor theory? Means in this, the distance, the thickness of the specimen, as I told you already, this is in terms of millimeter, means they are very close to each other. So this slab behaves as the capacitor, and we know that whenever charges accumulate on the plates of the capacitor, an electric field is going to develop between the plates of the capacitor. The electric field developed in the plates of the capacitor is given by the expression V by D, where V is the potential developed between the plates and D is the distance between the plates. As in our experiment, these two faces are behaving as a capacitor. The distance between this is nothing but a thickness. So I have taken E into D as the Hall voltage developed. So this expression reduces to RH into I into H divided by B. As I'm interested in calculating Hall coefficient here, just you cross multiply it, keeping the RH in the left hand side, we'll get the final expression for determination of Hall coefficient in the laboratory is given by the expression VH into B divided by I into H. So if the Hall voltage developed in the specimen is measured, if the breadth of the specimen is known, amount of current flowing in the specimen is known, strength of the field applied is known, then one can calculate Hall coefficient in the laboratory. So what is the importance of doing this calculation of Hall coefficient in the laboratory? We know that the very first importance is the Hall coefficient, as you told us, this is the expression for the Hall coefficient. The negative sign we got here, that is, as we have considered electrons as the charge carriers, we got it as negative sign. Suppose if you consider the conduction of current is due to the holes, then we will get that if you carry out the same type of calculations, we'll get this expression RH as positive value, that is plus 1 by NE. Therefore, the importance of the Hall coefficient is the it will determines the sign of the charge carrier which are present in the specimen. The next importance is one can measure the mobility of the charge carriers, and if the Hall constants means these breadth and RH are referred as Hall constant, then you can measure even a magnetic field also by knowing a Hall coefficient. And one more important thing we can measure is the concentration of the charge carriers can be measured experimentally. Why I am stressing this point experimentally here is, usually we will calculate the concentration of charge carriers using a theoretical formula as a ratio of Avogadro number into density divided by atomic weight, into number of free electrons per atom. So this is a theoretical formula for calculating a Hall coefficient, that is concentration of charge carriers. But if you measure a Hall coefficient experimentally, directly we can calculate the Hall coefficient, that is you can calculate the concentration of the charge carriers. So these are the importances of the Hall, determination of Hall coefficient. This is all about the Hall coefficient, Hall effect, and experimental determination and importance of the Hall effect. Thank you.